Thank you very much for the question. My journal, I think I will put a little bit back some years ago, when I was still young, when I was still young at school. It was the time when I finished my secondary school. It was the time that here in Mozambique, the government was deciding exactly what you can continue studying. And I was selected to be a teacher, to take a course to be a secondary school teacher in maths. And during that period, when I was at university to do that course, it was also launching the first Olympiad for mathematics. And I was the first girl at that time that I received the award of winning the mathematics Olympiad. And I think from that period that I was coming in newspaper and I was making that one was also giving me confidence that I can do even more. But also my father was someone who pushed me, or you push the girls at home to do more. So I think in terms of leadership and also trying to do things better, starting from home, but also at school as mathematics students. I didn't go to secondary school because the university just see that I was having some capability. They decide to put me continue studying to become a university lecturer. But the important is that also during that process, I changed my career paths. Instead of continuing with maths, I changed to technology. It was around the 80s where the technology was something different. And to start technology, computer for women was also something different. I still remember my professor at the university was asking, why a girl want to start the computer, and particular coming from Mozambique was something that different because at that time I was in Germany. But then I continued working at the university until in 2005, which also changed completely my career in terms of not be continue being only university lecturer or university professor as I am at the moment. I was invited by the Central Bank to be a member of the board and the executive director. I was very surprised why the Central Bank, I am not an economist, why the Central Bank is looking on me to be there. And when I arrived there, they were giving me a task related to currency and payment system. Really, in the area of payment system is where I saw a lot of application, practical application of things that I was teaching students at the university in the area of information system. And I started to see how I can contribute in the area of financial sector using my knowledge from technology. And it was also the time that we started to think on how can we bring more people to the formal financial sector. And I started with this movement of financial inclusion while I was at the Central Bank. And when I left the Central Bank, I was so much embedded with that sector of financial system of digital payments, but also on financial inclusion, asking myself, how can we bring more people to the formal? Because I was seeing financial inclusion, not just having a bank account, but some things that can be more inclusive. And it is why I entered to that process. And I am here today in front of FSD Mozambique, which is an organization that is dealing with financial inclusion in a very broad way. And I can also bring my knowledge, not only from the Central Bank, but also for the university where I'm still teaching. And really, I'm bringing some components for my practical to the university. So my journal, professional and life have been changed along the period of time. Yeah, if someone asked me what was the big challenge that I have faced, particularly in this last part of my professional journey, as someone who's working in financial sector, but also someone who was working in the mathematics, you might know that in that area of science and technology, we do have very few women. So my big challenge is that that I have faced is that first, you have to convince all of them that you are also capable to do that. So you need to do with very high professionalism, and you need to listen and also to understand and bring a solution that people can also recognize. So for me, as a woman, I think we have a double efforts compared to men. If we are in the same position, it is important that you make it working in the very high quality, because otherwise, if you are not having good results, I will say, yeah, because she was a woman in front of the project. So for me, that professionalism, the quality, and also the knowledge to do things is something that you as a woman, you need to have in your mind when you accept a specific task. Thank you for the question. This question has different angles. Maybe I will start with the first part when you are asking how FSD is looking or is positioned itself in these moments of COVID. Well, almost a year ago when the first case of COVID was reached in the country in March last year. And at that time, I'm still recalling that all of us, we were not clear exactly what is there, and we were not clear how long it's going to last. And then it was a moment that was declared a pandemic and they even become something. So in that regards, I think that we as organization, we have ourselves trying to identify how can we couple ourselves first as staff with this disease, what we can do, what is in our level. But at the same time, so we are checking to our partners, because as market facilitator, we work with partners, and we are going to see how our partners that are doing project with us are going to be affected with COVID, what we can do in order to reduce the impact, the negative impact of this disease. But at the same time, so we work together with the regulator and trying to see what are the measurements, what measurements that the regulator can put in place, because for us, we're seeing that there is a potentiality as one of the restriction was to be having physical contacts, so that there is a need to move on more and more to digital. And how can the regulator put major regulation that is allowing more people to use digital facilities. And that one was also real in terms of regulator side. But I can here also share with you experience. We were, for instance, planning a specific course with one local government entity in one of our provinces here in the country, dealing with the personal financial management. And that course was firstly designed to be in presence. And due to the COVID, it was not possible. And we organized that the course can be doing total online. And it was interesting because those civil servants in this district, some of them never work in the online space. And during that course, we teach them the financial management, but also they were teach the digital literacy in order to be able to perform the course. Another example that make us changing the way that we do things, when we had the COVID and all the restrictions were put in place by the governments, we were running a SADC hackathon. SADC is the Southern African Development Organization here in our region. And it was an hackathon on financial inclusion. And the hackathon bootcamp, they were all organized to be presential. And then COVID was reaching. It was the first time that together with our partner, we organized an hackathon that was completely online. And now we're able to have those hackathons and we are doing online. So COVID has bring us challenges in terms that was so very quick and require us to change and to see how can we continue be relevant for what we are doing, even if we have restriction. And here we have to thank technology because the technology is giving that opportunity. So that one is also things that I think for me was how technology can help us as organization, can help us as citizen, but also can help our partners to continue doing what they're doing. And the other examples can come for the areas that we're working. So COVID has bring, yes, challenge, but I think the one of the impact is that we're seeing a move for financial service provider, providing most of their service, even the onboard to be digital. So we're seeing a big move of using of technology to continue provide service that before were there. And you can see by banks and the mobile money also is increasing. But the other things that I want to emphasize in terms of impact is regarding the insurance side. Because we're working also in the area of insurance. And it was seen that health insurance, life insurance during this period of year, 2020, has increased. But whereas other type of insurance like accidents, or equipment insurance, they have declined significantly because some of the companies have been closed. Some of the companies do not need those kind of insurance. But people, they've recognized that they need to have health insurance. It is why the health insurance has given a big jump. So you have different impact, positive impact and negative impact. And in terms of the economy, there are negative impact because we have people that have lost their job. We have people that are not continuing to do what they're supposed to do, particularly when it's coming to a country where informal market is very huge. And to all those restrictions, those people that are in the last mile doing informal activities that could not do. We have been seeing also reduction in terms of cross-border trade because we do have a relationship with the South Africa. And in the time that where the border were closed, there were high decrease. We are a country where the tourism was very important and there is a very negative impact on tourism. The tourism is one of the sector that has been drastically affected by the COVID. And all those effects that have their reflection on the economy in the last day. You cannot do, unfortunately, the tourism totally digitally, and people and our tourism is more basically on beach, and we cannot go to the beach for almost a year, which is making some things difficult for some sector of the economy. But as I said, there is also transformation, and maybe COVID will help us to speed the process of building our digital economy. The COVID has hit all of us, but I think the big hit is for the people in the last mile. For instance, in rural areas, we do have people that are relying on remittance coming from South Africa, for instance. And due to the COVID, that even some Mozambicans that are working there, they were losing their job. So it seemed that the remittance has been reduced during that period. It was a government program from South Africa to see how they can help people that were using already digital remittance to be continue sending money home using those platforms. So there are impact for those people that are receiving international remittance, particularly the regional one. The other one is that, as I was mentioned In terms of informal market, we do have also a negative impact because most of the informal points of selling were closed and people could not send, could not continue to sell their product. Although we have starting other movement of saying how people can sell things digital, but it's not for those people from last mile. We still have to do a lot until we got those people selling their product use digital, fully digital platform. The other components in terms of agriculture, although directly, we can say that the agriculture cannot, was not directly affected in COVID in terms that they are continuing producing. But if you see that you need to continue have the support, technical support to the farmer or to this small world, the farmers, what they're doing. And now you have all those restrictions that only now we start to change a little bit, to relax some of the restrictions. So you can see how also the agriculture sector, which represented the majority, was affected. And the other area that in Mozambique was completely affected last year was the education, particular primary and secondary school. They were completely closed for a year because different for other countries where the academic year was ending around June, August. Our year when we started with the COVID was starting because we started in January. So it was really a disaster. And I do think that even still this year, we're still having problems in the education. And can you imagine a small child in the village? You cannot say that it's going to have online school in that condition because the infrastructure is not there, the teachers are not prepared. So there are, yes, some issue that maybe their impact we will continue seeing for many and many years, particularly those impacts that are related with education, because if you miss some things in education, then it's going to reflect for more and more time. The things that the financial sector, particular banks, they did was in terms of credit and loan for those people that had loans, which are not mostly the one that I was talking about, to restructure their loan and to see what came. The other things is that via government program on humanitarian side, it was, even the continuum, it was an support, giving support to those people that were completely affected, that they've lost their job, they've lost their main of source for due to the COVID. And the government is giving some financial support. And then is coming the financial institution to give support in terms of how do you provide those financial resources. The other things which is also linked to the government is the support to the small, medium enterprise. The government is now giving some grants, if I can say, or some money to support the recovery of the small medium enterprise. But that one is also not a fully picture to all companies, because as I mentioned, all of us have been affected, include the government, because the tax have been reduced and the company that closed, the tax has been reduced, meaning that the government has also less money. But we do have support for some international organizations that are supporting the government. My point of view, yes, we need to reinforce, but mostly we need to ask ourselves at these moments, and having in mind that COVID is not that something temporary, it's going to be with us more time. Even when as disease disappear, the effect that has created will last for more years. And in that view, from my point of view, is that yes, we need to reinforce and we need to rethink what does mean financial inclusion in that new reality. And my view is that it will be important to reform financial inclusion, particularly in the area of particular in the area of insurance, particular in the area of how do we minimize the effects coming for disasters. In this case was health disaster, but in the case of Mozambique, we are thinking a lot about the climate change and the disaster that are coming in the cyclone. So there is here a need to ask ourselves, how do we bring each of us preparing for some things like this pandemic in order to minimize the effect that we might have. Yes, we need to rethink and also to reinforce financial inclusion and to look to all dimensions of financial inclusion. And my view is that maybe if we look financial inclusion and trying to put our lens of financial inclusion within the SDGs, maybe we can also give a good contribution how financial inclusion would look like in the next years, moving for what used to be the focus of usage and also the access of financial inclusion, and now asking ourselves what is financial inclusion for the real economy, for the real life of the people, and also for the consequence of COVID. So I see a huge opportunity in that area. And one entity that is going to play a very important role here will be technology. And in technology, we will need to see how those new coming in the board of financial inclusion, fintechs, insurance tech, what solution they are bringing in order for us to minimize the impact of such a humanitarian disaster. Yes, as all of us were saying, that where there is a disaster, we have to look clearly because it might be also opportunity. And it is not different in this case. There is, for me, opportunities, yeah, which we need to take and make them real in our life. My recommendation or my thinking in terms of opportunity is that if we see how from this last year of disaster I've been working in distance, in our home, in things. So for me here, there is opportunity to rethink how we still need all those offices. How can we continue provide the service without not going there? And so I was saying that technology will have to help us in terms of the environment of work. Yes, there are challenges also are coming because we need to be sure how do you manage working in distance. But where I see huge opportunity is also within the banking sector. The question is, how can we have onboarding of new people coming to financial sector without going to the bank, without being in presence? That one will be also giving us a huge opportunity because maybe we are going to reach other people that before was not being in the bank, the distance issue will be disappearing. So I see here opportunity for the banks offering service for those people that usually were not using because we are far for their service. Another thing is that even within the financial sector, the banks can continue interact with their clients where they are without having a physical interaction. And if we create a good platform, good way of interacting and bringing the clients can be also a good opportunity. I see also our opportunity in the area of training, in the area of education, using those platforms. And that one maybe might reduce the way that we teach in the presence, but we need to see how we maximize that we are not going to low quality, how we maximize those online teaching. But I think the banking sector or financial sector has a huge opportunity. And in this kind was as is a sector that always was pushing the technology, the use of technology. And I think now with COVID, they've been doing a lot. And I do believe that we're going to see in future new products and new services that are designed for people to be used while they're not going to the physical address. So the movement of having bank everywhere is going for sure to go to reduce, and but we are going to continue having a banking service or financial service everywhere, not meaning to have a physical space for that. For the organization, international organization, I think they have also to put technology in their agenda, and they do that. But pushing more and more how we can use technology and help to put a resource to create those infrastructure in order to make them available. So my recommendation to the international organization is that it will be very important to identify local implementers that can better implement their purpose of support using technology and trying to reach the people that we don't want to leave them behind. We want to push them to our area, in this case of inclusive finance. But really, we know that also inside the technology, there are some barriers like cybersecurity, things like that, integrity, financial integrity, and the international organization. So can help us how we make sure that everything that we are doing is safe in terms of security and in terms of integrity. This was always my way of seeing things. I do believe on global development, but I do also believe that the global can only exist when there is local. So in saying that, is that we cannot only rely on international consultants. We need to have in our countries also people that can do the work. And for that one, maybe it's a time that we do have also this training in order to push local. We tend, for instance, here at the FSD, that if we have an international organization that we are hiring, we try to push if we can have someone local that are working with them as part of training and also interaction. I fully agree that we need to create a training process where in terms of consultants, in terms of leadership skills, we need to have people that local can also debate at the same level as international, because I do believe that if I am a woman, if I am a Mozambican, and I am not being part of the table where those things are discussed, because I don't have skill, because my voice is not going to be hearing, I don't think that we will be succeeding in this area of development. So there is a need that we equip ourselves in order to be in the same table where a big debate of development are being discussed. And this is only through capacity building.